Алматы. A warm good morning to all. I request you all to rise for Tamil Thai Vaazhthu. Now I request Mr. D. Selvam, former chairman and special committee member of War Council of Tamil Nadu and Puducherry, to deliver welcome address.
Good morning. எல்லோருக்கும் காலை வணக்கம். இன்று நடக்க இருக்கின்ற இந்த என்ரோல்மெண்ட் ஃபங்க்ஷனுக்கு நம்மோடு பல்கிவாலா ஃபவுண்டேஷன் உடன் சேர்ந்து வழக்கறிஞர்களுக்கு கடந்த 15 நாட்களாக நடைபெற்று கொண்டிருக்கின்ற கண்டினியூங் லீகல் எஜுகேஷன் ப்ரோக்ராம் அதற்கு முடிவாக அதற்கு நிறைவு விழாவாக வந்திருக்கின்ற நம்முடைய மூத்த வழக்கறிஞர் நவ் இஸ் ப்ராக்டிஸ் சுப்ரீம் கோர்ட் ஹி வாஸ் ப்ராக்டிஸ் இன் டெல்லி சென்னை நவ் இஸ் ஆல்சோ ப்ராக்டிஸிங் நவ் இஸ் ப்ராக்டிஸ் சுப்ரீம் கோர்ட் சீனியர் அட்வொகேட் மிஸ்டர் அரவிந்த் தத்தார் அவர்களே மற்றும் இந்த விழாவிற்கு வந்திருக்கின்ற பல்கிவாலா ஃபவுண்டேஷனுடைய ஆர்கனைசர்ஸ் ஜெயக்குமார் சார் அவர்களே மற்றும் இந்த விழாவிற்கு வந்திருக்கின்ற பார் கவுன்சில் மெம்பர் கே கே எஸ் ஜெயராமன் அவர்களே முன்னாள் வைஸ் சேர்மேன் ராஜாஜி அவர்களே இங்கு அமர்ந்திருக்கின்ற மூத்த வழக்கறிஞர்களே வழக்கறிஞர் மூத்த வழக்கறிஞர் ஆனந்த் வெங்கடேஷ் அவர்களே மற்றும் இங்கே அமர்ந்திருக்கின்ற சகோதர சகோதரிகளே வழக்கமாக பார் கவுன்சிலுடைய என்ரோல்மெண்ட்டில் நாங்கள் வந்து நிறையா வந்து பார் கவுன்சில் உங்களுக்கு அட்வைஸ் பண்ணோம் இப்போது இந்த பல்கிவாலா ஃபவுண்டேஷனுடைய உதவியோடு நாட் ஓன்லி ஹியர் இந்தியாவில் உள்ள தமிழகத்தில் உள்ள அனைத்து வழக்கறிஞர்களும் பார்க்கும் அளவிற்கு ஆன்லைனில் இப்போ வந்து அவங்க கொடுத்துட்ருக்காங்க எவ்ரிடே ஈவினிங் ஒவ்வொரு நாளும் மாலையில் இங்கு கிளாஸ் நடத்தப்பட்டு கொண்டிருந்தது கடந்த 15 நாட்களாக நடந்து கொண்டிருந்தது மூத்த வழக்கறிஞர்கள் நீதிபதிகள் எல்லோருமே வந்து கிளாஸ் எடுத்துகிட்டு இருந்தாங்க இன்றைக்கி நிறைவு விழாவாக அது இன்று இப்போ அது வெக்கேஷன் வர்றதுனால ஸோ ஆஃப்டர் வெக்கேஷன் திரும்ப வந்து நாங்கள் இதை கன்யூ பண்ண போகிறோம் பார் கவுன்சில் இல்லை நம்மளுடைய ஃபவுண்டேஷன்ஸ் நம்முடைய மூத்த ஐயன்டோலி இருக்காங்க பெரிய பெரிய வழக்கறிஞர்களோட ட்ரஸ்டெல்லாம் இருக்குது அவங்கெல்லாம் வந்து இங்கே அப்ரோச் பண்ணிகிட்ருக்காங்க அவங்க மூலமாக நம்ம வந்து பார் கவுன்சிலில் எவ்ரிடே அதாவது நாங்கள் உங்களுக்கு வெப்சைட்டில் போடுவோம் எவ்ரிடே ஈவினிங் வந்து கிளாஸ் எடுக்கும் கிளாஸ் இங்கே நடக்கும் பர்டிகுலராக யங் அட்வொகேட்ஸ் நீங்கள்லாம் வந்து அதை பார்த்து தெரிஞ்சுக்கணும் அதே போல் தமிழகத்தில் உள்ள மற்ற வழக்கறிஞர்கள் பார்த்து தெரிந்து கொள்ளும் அளவிற்கு வெப்சைட்டு இருக்கிறது தமிழ்நாடு பார் கவுன்சில் வெப்சைட் இருக்கிறது அதில் ஆன்லைன் மூலமாக லைவாக டெலிகாஸ்ட் பண்ண போகிறோம் இப்போயும் அவங்க பண்ணிகிட்ருக்காங்க இருந்தால் நம்ம அதை லைவாக டெலிகாஸ்ட் பண்ண போகிறோம் ஸோ இப்போதைக்கு எனக்கு கிடைச்ச தகவல் படி கிட்டத்தட்ட 500-600 பேர் எவ்ரிடே பார்த்துட்ருக்காங்க இதை இந்த லெக்சர் நடக்கிறத வந்து தமிழ்நாட்டிலேருந்து ஒரு 500 மெம்பர்ஸ்க்கு மேலே பார்க்குறாங்கன்னு சொல்லி எனக்கு வந்த தகவல் ஸோ ஏன்னா அது கம்மி தான் தமிழகத்தில் வந்து கிட்டத்தட்ட இப்போ 92,000 அட்வொகேட்ஸ் இருக்கும் ஸோ அதனால் இன்னமும் மூத்த வழக்கறிஞர்கள் தேவையில்லைன்னா கூட இளம் வழக்கறிஞர்கள் கண்டிப்பாக நீங்கள் பார்த்து அதை வெப்சைட் மூலமாக இங்கே வர முடியாத பட்சத்தில் வெப்சைட் மூலமாக ஆன்லைனில் நீங்கள் அதை பார்த்து நீங்கள் கற்றுக்கிறணும். இன்றைக்கி நான் உங்களுக்கெல்லாம் என்ன லக்குன்னா, நாங்கள்லாம் வந்து அவர் அப்பாயின்மெண்ட் வாங்குறதுக்கே ரொம்ப கஷ்டம். சீனியர் அட்வொகேட் அரவிந்த் தர்சாட்ட நாங்கள் வந்து அப்பாயின்மெண்ட் வாங்குறதே ரொம்ப கஷ்டம். ஏன்னா லாஸ்ட் டைம் வந்து பார் கவுன்சிலுடைய கேஸுக்காக சாரை பார்க்க முடியாமல் கூட நாங்கள் வந்தோம். அப்புறம் சார்கிட்ட கேட்டு அப்ரோச் பண்ண சார் சரின்னு சொல்லியிருந்தார். ஸோ அவருடைய சர்வீஸ் நாட் ஓன்லி இன் தமிழ்நாடு, டெல்லி ஆல்சோ, அவருடைய அப்பாயின்மெண்ட் கிடச்சி இன்றைக்கி வந்து உங்களுக்கு அவர் லெக்சர் கொடுக்குறாருன்னா, ஐ திங்க் ரியலி யூ ஆர் ஏ லக்கி லக்கி ஸ்டூடெண்ட்ஸ், லக்கி அட்வொகேட்ஸ் ஆல்சோ. ஸோ அதனால் இந்த விழாவிற்கு அவர் வந்து உங்களுக்கு லெக்சர் இன்றைக்கி கான்ஸ்டியூஷனை எடுக்க போகிறாரு. ஸோ அவரை வருக வருக என்று வரவேற்று உங்கள் அனைவருக்கும் வாழ்த்துக்கள் சொல்லி வருகின்றேன். நன்றி, வணக்கம்.
தேங்க்யூ சார். நவ் ஐ ரிக்வெஸ்ட் மிஸ்டர் பி ராஜாஜி, அட்வொகேட், ஃபார்மர் வைஸ் சேர்மன் ஆஃப் பார் கவுன்சில் ஆஃப் தமிழ்நாடு, டு மூவ் தி என்ரோல்மெண்ட். ஆல் கேண்டிடேட்ஸ் ப்ளீஸ் ரைஸ்.
ஆன் பிகாஃப் ஆஃப் தி ஆல் தி அட்வொகேட்ஸ், I move the enrollment of all the new candidates in the Bar Council of Tamil Nadu. I wish him all success and great success. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Now, I request Mr. K.K. Jayaraman, ADA committee member of Bar Council of Tamil Nadu and Puducherry, to administer oath.
அனைவருக்கும் வணக்கம். நான் ஐ என்று சொல்லும்போது உங்களுடைய பெயரை சேர்த்துக்கொள்ளும். ஐ do solemnly swear that I shall uphold the Constitution of India and rule of law, that I shall maintain the respect due to Court of Justice, judicial officers and members of my profession, and will at all times conduct myself with dignity, becoming of an officer of the court in which I appear, that I shall at all times conduct myself in accordance with the rules of professional conduct and etiquettes as prescribed by the Bar Council of India, State Bar Council, from time to time, and as reflected in this noble profession, including ethical duties and moral values. Please sit down. அன்பார்ந்த வழக்கறிஞர்களே, மேடையில் அமர்ந்திருக்கும் விருந்தினர்களே, உங்கள் அனைவருக்கும் என்னுடைய காலை வணக்கத்தை தெரிவித்துக் கொள்கிறேன். வழக்கறிஞர் நண்பர்களே, இந்த நிமிடத்திலிருந்து நீங்கள் எல்லாம் வழக்கறிஞர்கள். அன்றைக்கு காந்தி முதல் இன்றைய ஒபாமா வரை வழக்கறிஞர்கள் என்பது உங்கள் அனைவருக்கும் தெரிந்த ஒன்று. நீங்கள் தற்போது உறுதிமொழி ஏற்றுள்ளீர்கள். இதனுடன் இரண்டே இரண்டு உறுதிமொழியை தாங்கள் சேர்த்துக் கொள்ள வேண்டும். ஏனென்று சொன்னால், இந்த நிமிடத்திலிருந்து நீங்கள் வழக்கறிஞர்கள். யாரோ ஒரு சில வழக்கறிஞர்கள் செய்யும் தவறுகளால் வழக்கறிஞர் என்றால் சமுதாயத்தில் வேறு ஒரு பார்வை இருக்கிறது. நீங்கள் இந்த நேரத்தில் எடுத்துக்கொள்ள வேண்டிய ஒரு உறுதிமொழி, என்னால் இந்த தொழிலுக்கு எந்த கண்ணிய குறைவோ ஏற்படாது என்பதை இந்த நேரத்தில் நீங்கள் உறுதிமொழியாக எடுத்துக்கொள்ள வேண்டும். மேலும் இங்கு உங்களுக்கு ஆலோசனை வழங்குவதற்காக மூத்த வழக்கறிஞர் திரு சீனியர் அட்வொகேட் அவர்கள் அருண் பி தத்தர் அவர்கள் வருகை தந்துள்ளார்கள். அவர்களுடைய ஆலோசனைகளை பெற்று நீங்கள் நல்ல வழக்கறிஞர்களாக எதிர்காலத்தில் வர வேண்டும் என்று இறைவனை வணங்கி வாழ்த்து உங்களை எல்லாரும் வாழ்த்து விடைபெறுகிறேன். நன்றி, வணக்கம்.
தேங்க்யூ சார். நவ் ஐ ரிக்வெஸ்ட் மிஸ்டர் வி எஸ் ஜெயக்குமார், சீனியர் அட்வொகேட், டு ரிப்போர்ட் அபவுட் தி லெக்சர் சீரீஸ்.
மிஸ்டர் டி செல்வம், மிஸ்டர் ராஜாஜி, மிஸ்டர் கே கே எஸ் ஜெயராமன், மை குட் ஃப்ரெண்ட் மிஸ்டர் தாத்தார், அண்ட் மெம்பர்ஸ் ஆஃப் தி டயஸ், டிஸ்டிங்விஷ்ட் லேடிஸ் அண்ட் ஜென்டில்மென். நவ் திஸ் லெக்சர் ஹஸ் பீன் கோயிங் ஆன் லாஸ்ட் 15 டேஸ். வி ட்ரை டு அனலைஸ் தி லைவ் ஸ்ட்ரீம் ஹிட்ஸ் ஆல் ஓவர் தமிழ்நாடு. The information is what we got is the times of overall views 13,500 minutes. The total views were 4,150, of which subscribers are 37. The share are 53, playlist is 28. Male viewers about 63%, female viewers are about 38%. These are all local Indian. Internationally, it is viewed in Singapore 38 regular people, and United States 36 people, Sweden 34, Brazil 2, Oman 5, UK 5, Saudi Arabia 9, and unknown region is 38. So in India, it comes to about 2,087. This is the kind of encouragement you all have given, including the Bar Council of Tamil Nadu and Puducherry. We owe a lot to them. Now, a great pleasure on behalf of the Palkiwala Foundation to call you for the last of this lecture series by my good friend Mr. Arvind P. Datar, who will talk about the constitutional aspects and legal ethics. And in the last 2 weeks, we have heard eminent speakers in the field of law who offered the guidance to youngsters and also shared with you their experience in the courts and outside the courts. In fact, most of them spoke on the art of advocacy, what they learned from the predecessor senior counsels in the yester years. So with this background, and Mr. Datar is in the last of this today's lecture, and I have great pleasure in introducing him as an expert in constitutional law, taxation laws, company law, commercial law, arbitration, and F1 racing. He is an author, debater, columnist, and a good human being. If you have to introduce him in tax language, I call him a block of assets stored with humility, compassion, and charitable in nature. If you have to introduce him in company law language, he is an amalgamation of good conduct, hard work, and industrious person who pays rich dividends. I have to introduce him from constitutional law language. He is a true citizen who fights for fundamental rights and duties. He is in the concurrent list because half the time he is in Delhi, other half is in Chennai. And if I am permitted a legal angle, he is a walking encyclopedia. If I go by the biological language, he is the reincarnation of Palkiwala, M.C. Settlewad, and F.E. Smith. I have to use a commercial advertisement language from Raymond's. He is a complete man. In one word, you want to introduce him, he is a unique Arvind Datar with no comparable person I have come across so far, a man par excellence. Ladies and gentlemen, he is a good friend, mentor, philosopher, and guide to many who interact with him. Over to you, Mr. Datar.
Thank you, sir. Now I request Mr. Arvind B. Datar, senior advocate, to deliver the valedictory address.
Good morning and congratulations to all of you. The dignitaries on the dais, my very dear friend Jay Kumar, he didn't mention that I learned the basics of taxation from him, and he defined me under various branches of law. I was wondering what he's going to say as far as I'm concerned in criminal law. So he stopped short of that. But I'm really grateful to the Bar Council for inviting me to speak, and I was told to speak on constitutional law and also to give some advice on how to succeed at the bar. All of you have enrolled. You are now at the starting point of a great and glorious career. And after I speak briefly on the constitution, I will tell you, because I was enrolled in 1980, so I'm 37 years old in the bar, and perhaps older than most of you. I mean, I've got more years in the bar than you've got years in this world. So I can just narrate to you what are my experiences, because we all learned from our seniors. We learned from their practices. They were our mentors. They gave us the guidelines. And I can simply share my thoughts with you. And it's up to you to test it and accept it if it is worthwhile. Now, first of all, let us come to the Constitution of India. And I'll be as brief as possible. As all of you know, in 1935, we had the first Government of India Act, which introduced the concepts of a provincial legislature and a federal legislature. This Government of India Act, now when the Constituent Assembly was started, they first decided that they will continue with what is called the Westminster model of government, that is the British parliamentary model of government. You'll have a lower house, you'll have an upper house. There'll be separation of powers. You'll have a legislature, an executive and a judiciary. And they said that what was in the Government of India Act will be continued. Because if you see the initial speeches, particularly of Sardar Patel, partition was a very traumatic event for all of us, as all of you know. Lakhs lost their lives, and there was no time for any kind of change. So they said it is better that we continue the existing system of government. Instead of ICS, we'll have the IAS, we'll have the IPS, we'll have the same system of the judiciary, the police, the administration, and so on. And so that there was a continuation. The Constitution is different from the Government of India Act 1935 in only two respects. The Government of India Act did not have a chapter on fundamental rights. Part 3, I think, I'm sure all of you must have studied the Constitution, and you'll remember that Part 3 is the chapter on fundamental rights, and Part 4 is the chapter on directive principles. I don't want to revisit the Constitution because most of you have studied it. You know that Article 14 comes from the 14th Amendment, this clause comes from the Japanese Constitution, all that you have studied. But Part 3 and Part 4 were introduced into our Constitution. And two more articles which are of very great importance were introduced in the Constitution, which are Articles 226 and 227 of the Constitution, which we call the writ remedies which are available. The Constitution makers gave us rights. You have the right to equality, you have the right to speech, your right to freedom of religion. But suppose somebody violates that right, what is your remedy? You have studied ubi jus, ubi remedium. So where there is a right, there must also be a remedy. The mechanism to enforce these rights was done through Article 226 and 227 and also Article 32 of the Constitution, where you could directly approach the Supreme Court. And Dr. Ambedkar said that if he were to choose the most important article in the Constitution, he would say it is Article 32. In practice, generally Supreme Court says don't come straight to the Supreme Court. First, invoke Article 226, try out the remedies in the High Court, and only then come to the Supreme Court. Of course, in rare cases, they do entertain it, like we are doing this Aadhaar case just now, which is directly Article 32 petition. Right? We are doing the case for LGBT. That's also a direct Article 32 petition. So the rule is generally you go to the High Court. Now you must have all studied theoretically what are the kinds of writs, is it not? You studied writ of certiorari, writ of mandamus. I think I'm giving you memories of your law college. But these are all the remedies which you have to exercise if your rights are infringed. And you don't realize, or all of us don't realize, how important and vital these rights are. In the Madras High Court, if I am not mistaken, about 45,000 writ petitions are filed per year, approximately. I do not know the figure for Madurai, but I am told it is equally high. So effectively, there are 45,000 cases where a citizen is aggrieved by the action of the state. It could be disconnection of an electricity meter, it could be demolition of a building, it could be a wrong tax demand under the Sales Tax Act. Whatever it is, your rights, statutory rights, constitutional rights are infringed, but you go to many of these Asian countries, other countries, you have no right. The rights are only in the book. If you read the constitution of China, there are so many rights, freedom of speech, nobody can enter your house and so on, but we know the reality is quite different. But as far as we are concerned, the citizen has got the right to approach the courts to ensure that his statutory and fundamental rights are not violated. And that forum is the High Court of each particular state. Madras High Court, you've got a Madurai bench, you go to Bombay, you've got the Bombay High Court, you've got the Nagpur bench, the Aurangabad bench. So where the states are large, they have open benches, but each bench has got concurrent jurisdiction to issue writs of mandamus, certiorari, and so on. Should I mention about, do you know all the writs? I don't have to waste time on that then. About habeas corpus and so on. Would you like me to talk about it, or do you know about it? What should I, they must have studied. I'll just briefly, because I thought I'll rather tell you about how to get on to practice and so on. That may be more important than this. Anyway, yes. Now, as far as writs are concerned, when I was a young junior, there used to be only one writ court and the number of writs were very, very few. Now you find there are large number of writ petitions, more and more people approach the writ petitions. And there was a time when there were lesser number of writs and more number of suits. Now the number of writ petitions are 8 times the number of suits. In fact, one disturbing thing which I find is when I was a junior, the 5th City Civil Court was the court for family matters, for divorce matters. And it used to sit on Friday afternoons only. There were so few matrimonial cases, divorce cases. They used to have only on Friday afternoons, 2:30 were the matrimonial disputes. Today the number of matrimonial disputes are more than the civil disputes. You have a separate large building only for. So this is how the litigation changes. My seniors used to tell me that earlier most of the litigation was property oriented. Zamindari abolition, abolition of land tenures. So basically the litigation was land oriented. After the writs came, the litigation is more rights based. Somebody violates my right, I approach the court. Then later you had the huge development of public interest litigation, particularly after Maneka Gandhi in 1978, where they found that the executive is not performing its duty. For example, in pollution, despite the Pollution Act, pollution controls unchecked, what do? You come to a high court and say that please stop this pollution, don't allow them to discharge effluents and so on. So high court started getting it. It became so bad that we then started having one green bench per high court, and finally you have now the national green tribunal and you have the state green tribunals. So as far as writs are concerned, the basic writs are habeas corpus, where a person is you have to produce the body, either a person in custody is not known, or sometimes a particular person is abducted, so you can go to court and do habeas corpus. And when I was a junior, I was told that habeas corpus takes utmost priority, and any matter comes, habeas corpus will be taken first and disposed, because nothing is more precious than the liberty of a citizen. Now you've got mandamus, which is to ensure that people perform their public duty. Now all of you are going to start practice. My advice to you is, before you go to the writ court, kindly first practice in the civil courts and the criminal courts before you shift to the writ courts. The general tendency is to straight away go to the writ court, and that becomes a handicap later in life. It's like going straight away for neurosurgery without doing basically outpatient work. You don't know the basics of the treatment of a patient, but you want to go for specialization. So you have writ of mandamus, where you ask the public authority to perform its duty, or to stop a public authority from doing what it's not supposed to do. So it can either do something or it can forbear from doing something. Certiorari is more common. Certiorari is to quash an order of any lower authority, lower court. You can quash the order of the lower authority. Now there are judgments of the Supreme Court which say that if it's a judicial order, then there is no question of 226, only 227 lies. But if it's, say, for example, a sales tax authority or a pollution authority or a CMDA approval, it can always be quashed by the High Court if that order suffers from what is called error of law. What? Tell me, error of law what? Apparent on the face of the record. That's the definition of certiorari. Then you got quo warranto, which is very, very seldom used. Suppose I'm appointed as a senior officer, like say I'm a vice chancellor of a university, or I'm appointed as advocate general. I don't have the requisite qualifications. Quo warranto means by what authority? How do you hold that post? You're unfit, you don't have the necessary qualifications. That is quo warranto. So these are, and of course you got the very important writ of prohibition. Prohibition is a preemptive writ. If you know an authority is going to do something which it's not supposed to do, you need not wait till the damage is done. In advance you can go to the court and say, look, he is going to come and demolish my wall, he is going to take away my money through taxation or confiscation, please stop him. So that is the thing. One thing as far as writ remedy is concerned is that one very, very important principle. See, as and when the writ remedies become large, now if you've got 40,000 cases, it's not possible for the court to go on to merits of every case. The whole judiciary will be paralyzed. So what do they say? They first have a filter. And the most important filter is the filter of alternate remedy. They ask you, do you have an alternate remedy? It's a sales tax order. Why don't you go on appeal? Why are you coming to the High Court? A pollution matter, why don't you go to the Green Tribunal? So where the law provides for an alternate remedy, they say first exhaust that remedy, and High Court then becomes, you knock on the door only as a kind of a last resort. Then there are whole jurisprudence on when alternate remedy applies, when it does not apply, and so on and so forth. Now, as far as the constitution is concerned, I will tell you later what books to read if you are interested in further developing that particular branch of law. But the Constitution of India, as you know, is the longest constitution in the world. There are many constitutions which are general in nature. If you see the US Constitution, it's very, very general. But the Indian Constitution is extremely elaborate because it basically borrowed the Government of India Act and added on to it these fundamental rights and the directive principles and a few other articles here and there. And of course, then you had separate schedules for us, right, which were added. So this is the entire constitutional structure. And the entire law of writs, today if you take the total number of cases, writ cases will be the largest number of cases in India. And the source of all the writ petitions are basically Article 226 in the High Courts and Article 32 in the Supreme Court. So this is as far as constitutional law is concerned. Very rarely you will find a case on a constitution itself. I mean, it will be something under the Electricity Act for which you invoke Article 226. So 226 and 32 are a method or a procedure or a tool, so to speak, to enable you to get your rights enforced. Now, since time at my disposal is short, I've been asked to tell you about, the chairman also said, speak about some advice to youngsters about practice. Now, I must first tell you that life is not easy. Many years ago, Ram Jethmalani came to the High Court Association and he was working with Barrister Asaf Ali. You must have heard of Aruna Asaf Ali, who was a famous lady. Asaf Ali was a freedom fighter and he told Jethmalani that whatever happens, if you are unable to spend 15-16 hours a day, you might as well leave the profession in the beginning. Don't waste your time. So I want to tell you that it is a difficult life, it's a tough life if you want to make a mark in the bar. I don't want to give any rosy picture. I've been through it for 37 years. I've seen people go to heights. I've seen people not succeeding. And one thing which I wrote the book with Mr. Sorabji on Palkhiwala, one thing which fascinated me right from the beginning was what makes some people superstars, what makes a Michael Jordan, what makes a Michael Phelps, what makes a Maria Sharapova, why people have. Please note, there's a book called Outliers. Outliers, O-U-T-L-I-E-R-S. Most important thing for the bar is you must have a tremendous passion for reading. That's a mandatory thing. You just forget your TV, forget the TV serials, and just focus on reading. Some things I may tell you may not be pleasant, but I'm just telling you out of interest. You're all like my sons and daughters. My children are older than most of you. And I will tell you what the same thing I would have told to my own daughter and son, because I must tell you in the beginning, it's a fantastic profession, but it just requires enormous amount of hard work. Ultimately, you must decide where I want to go. Right? If you want to reach an Olympic level, it requires 15 hours a day. If you want to practice in the local street cricket, you can just practice for half an hour. It's your own choice. But Outliers, this gentleman, Anders Ericsson, he's on YouTube. Anders Ericsson. He was wanting to know what makes a person, like an A.R. Rahman, why is this person at a superstardom and why others are not? Then he analyzed that why some violinists are achieving super success and others are not. He goes to surgeons. Why some surgeons have achieved super success, others have not. He goes to doctors. Why some doctors have reached heights, others have not. In other words, across all fields, whether it is music, it is sports, it is medicine, perhaps law, what is the LCM of all these people who have succeeded? And the answer, what he called deliberate practice, and what is called, now it's known all over the world as 10,000 hour rule. It is called the 10,000 hour rule. Whether you are a Mozart or a Beethoven or a Michael Jordan, all people who achieve mastery have spent 10,000 hours in their craft before they get mastery. We see the success of a person, but we forget the enormous work of what people do in private. I was watching a video on Michael Phelps. You know, he has won more gold medals than anybody in history. So typically an Olympic athlete would do, say, 8 hours of one session of practice. He used to do two of those practices every day. And he practiced all Sundays also. After the Athens Olympics, he said, I must break the record of Michael Spitz. So he said, I'll work on Sundays also, then I'll get 52 extra practice days in a year. So that was his intense thing. And then finally he broke all records. So the first thing is 10,000 hour rule. And you can also see a video of Jim Cathcart. Jim, C-A-T-H-C-A-R-T. He makes a very interesting proposition, which is very useful for all of us. He says, now this, listen to this carefully, all of you can do this very easily. He says, if you spend 1 hour a day in your field, whether it's civil engineering or law or medicine, 1 hour a day learning in your field, 1 hour dedicated hour, then in 5 years' time, you are guaranteed to be a world authority in your subject, mathematically. So 2017, if all of you, suppose you decide to take up, study 1 hour a day in your field, maybe arbitration, maybe criminal law, maybe whatever law, in 2022, I will say this lady, oh, she is a world leader in criminal law because she followed what Jim Cathcart says. And his thing is based on scientific evidence. So it is nothing but, when I studied it, I said, it's not, see what happens is, it all depends on what you do daily. And that's why your daily rituals are very important. What do you do? How many hours? You see, Anthony Trollope puts it beautifully. He says, a small task, be it daily, will beat the efforts of a spasmodic Hercules. That is, doing a simple task every day is worth more than doing suddenly some, for 2 months you start working heavily. No, it's a single daily things you must do. And somebody defined success as what? Successive succession of successful days. So each day should be a masterpiece, each day you should work hard. So one thing you should know is the 10,000 hour rule, studying 1 hour in your field. Now, please remember, it's again a mathematical rule. You must have heard of the 80-20 rule. Do you know the 80-20 rule? There was a mathematician from Florence, Wilfred Pareto. He found out that 80% of the work goes to 20% of the people. Go to the bar, go to any high court. 80% of the work will be done by 20% of the lawyers. Go to doctors. 80% of the patients will go to 20% of the doctors. So this is a rule, and your goal should be to be within that 80%. Somebody said that between average to good is a huge jump. Good to excellent is another huge jump. But from excellent to outstanding is just a very narrow thing above. Right? So remember the 80-20 rule. It all depends in your hands. If you work that extra mile, you spend 1 hour a day, do the 10,000 hour rule, you are guaranteed to be in the 20%. And let me tell you, I said it's life is tough, but the silver lining to the practice in the bar is this. If you work hard, you work systematically, then you cannot fail. Success is guaranteed. I can assure you that. Somebody said success leaves clues. There is a formula for success. If I tell you what is 2 into 3, you know 6. Right? I ask you what is 6 into 3, you know 18. Suppose I say 225 into 492. You will take a piece of paper and do it, but you will get the answer. Why? You know the formula. So once you know the formula, and I will give the 7 steps to goal setting later, which I have used and I have, is to some help. So I said 80-20 rule, I said the 10,000 hour rule, I said the 1 hour of practice. Now, please remember one thing. I am saying this, it may not be politically correct, but if you want to succeed at the High Court and Supreme Court level, you have to master the English language. It's very nice to be very proud of the local language. Speaking for myself, I'm from Maharashtra. I started my life in a Marathi medium school. When I came to Chennai, I only knew Marathi. We speak only Marathi at home. English is a foreign language. But it's only by habit and practice that we are able to develop the English language. So if you want to be reach anywhere in the heights of the legal profession, there is no choice but to learn the English language and master the English language. That is a must, I tell you very, very frankly. Because as you grow higher and higher and more, then the major cases you'll be able to do only if you are able to have felicity of language. It is your choice, because I find in Maharashtra or in Tamil Nadu and so on, it's very nice to be proud of your language. Yes, very, your culture is very great, your language is very great, but whether you like it or not, our courts are in English. So you have to master the English language. And what will I tell you to do as far as the English language is concerned? The first thing I'll request you in all sincerity is, on a daily basis, try to speak English as much as possible if you want to succeed at the bar. I know I may be saying something which is politically incorrect, but believe me, none of us are Englishmen. We are all Maharashtrians or Bengalis or Tamilians or Telugu, and we all speak our mother tongues at home. English is a foreign language. So unless you make the extra effort, it's going to be difficult. It's up to you. If you don't want to, then don't blame anybody that you're not going beyond, you're not able to make a mark in the High Court. Second important point is, please read biographies of all the leading lawyers. There's a lovely book by Sudhish Pai called Legends of the Law. He has given the biographies of 46 great lawyers. What a life they have led. Motilal Setalwad, Ashutosh Mukherjee, brilliant geniuses in those days. And mind you, they did all this without the internet. So read the biographies of all people. What I did in law college was, unfortunately, when I first studied, first year was the emergency in 1976-77, and all the colleges, everything we had, colleges went on time, there was no strike, nothing. After the emergency, unfortunately, a lot of time was wasted in strikes and so on and so forth. So we had a lot of spare time. So I used to spend my time in the High Court, or I used to go to the Connemara Library. If you go to the Connemara Library, in the ground floor, there's a section on biographies. And there is one section on legal biographies. And you have the lives of all the great lawyers. You have Hidayatullah, you have Motilal Setalwad, the lives of Katju, Kailashnath Katju, then all the English great lawyers, Lord Denning, Lord Diplock, Lord Bitt, and you learn so much from them. For example, I read the biography of Rufus Isaacs. Rufus Isaacs was a Jew. He first started life as a stockbroker. Lost everything in the stock market. He was about to be jailed. Then he joined the merchant navy, worked as a sailor, earned some money there, was able to partly pay his this thing. Then he joined the bar. The day he joined the bar, he joined one barrister called Lawson Walton. And he told him, Rufus, be the first person to come to the chamber and be the last person to leave. And Rufus Isaacs, all his life, his secret was, Rufus Isaacs ultimately, he became the leading lawyer, he became the attorney general, he ultimately took the title of Lord Reading. You know, when you become a lord, you take a title. And he was the Viceroy of India for some time as Lord Reading. From a person who completely was nowhere in life by sheer thing. And you know what was the secret of his success? He said every morning he got up at 4 o'clock. And from 4 to 8, he read all his papers from 4 to 8. Then he would go to practice, go to chambers by 9:30, work there till 5 o'clock. And then evening he would attend parliament. He was a member of parliament also. But throughout his life, he maintained the practice of getting up at 4. And why I'm mentioning it, these are all things. Now, you may not want to get up at 4 in it, but you can get up at 5 and 5 to 7, you can work. So, what I'm saying is, these are all great lawyers, and you can find clues. What did they do which I can duplicate? How can I follow that? And that's how you can become great. So, I'm just giving an example on one Rufus Isaacs, what he did, this thing. You take the biography of Lord Macmillan. He said, when you argue a case, you picture yourself in the position of a judge. How will the judge write a judgment? So present your arguments in order that you get an effective judgment. So there's no time now, but if you read each and every biography, you will know the success factors of individuals which you can develop. Other thing you must do is, if at all you watch any TV, one very, very important. There is a good book called Deep Work. You can note it down. Deep Work by Cal Newport. He is a theoretical computer scientist from Harvard, and he has written something called Deep Work. And I'm going to tell something which all of you will ask me to immediately leave this hall. He said, first thing is quit Facebook and Twitter. So, of course, my children also don't obey me or follow me on that, so I leave it to you. But his point is that you require huge amount of distracted time to have achievements. Right? Take the life of Saina Nehwal, the badminton champion. From 5:30 in the morning to 8:30, no TV, nothing, is just relentless practice. One ice cream cone on Sundays. So that's how they get that. So it's up to us to decide how. My grandmother used to tell me, you take a statue made of stone. In Marathi it sounds very nice. She says that the more beautiful the statue, the more cuts it has taken. So this is what, I don't know what is the equivalent Tamil proverb, but this is a... Okay, so I think so each language has got its own thing. So it's similar proverb in Marathi. Then instead of spending time on TV, take YouTube lectures. Yesterday, while I was in the gym in Delhi, for 55 minutes I heard a lecture of Rohinton Nariman, it's on the YouTube, on dissenting judgments of the Supreme Court. Beautiful, brilliant. He takes important dissenting judgments given by Fazal Ali. I never knew, you see, I am practicing for 37 years, I never knew that Fazal Ali was a judge only for 2.5 years. And his decisions, dissenting opinions in A.K. Gopalan and 2, 3 or 4 other cases, in 2 years, what a mark he made. Vivian Bose, Hidayatullah. So Justice Nariman has given lectures only on dissenting judgments. So like that, if you go to YouTube, you'll have important lectures which you can hunt. Secondly, third thing I'll make is, whenever you either read biographies or listen to lectures, keep a notebook like this ready with you and keep on making notes. Scientifically, whatever you hear, within 24 hours you forget 96% of what you have heard. When you note it down, the retention comes to almost 70%. This is inversion. So if you hear something down, I have a habit of keeping a notebook all the time. So if you hear something, just jot it down there and you can post it to some other notebook. So as I said, master your language, read biographies. If you're going to spend time, watch YouTube lectures, important lectures. One more thing I'll tell you which I did, which I can also share with you. I hope all of you are not getting bored with too much advice. But one thing I did was, when the TV first came in the 80s, you had one Hindi serial called Hum Log. I don't know, all of you will be very, very young at that time. It was everyday TV serial. And I never understood what is the great purpose in listening to what happens to a family. You know, some mother-in-law is fighting, daughter-in-law is being harassed. What's the point? I mean, okay, it's happening. Okay, how does it improve my life? No. So while the family were watching it, I decided to sit there and read 2 Privy Council judgments a day. I bought a set of old Privy Council judgments from one very old bookseller, and I started reading 2 Privy Council judgments a day. I will advise you, what you do is, if you are interested in really developing, from 1950, start with the Supreme Court. Start with A.K. Gopalan. Read 1 or 2 Supreme Court judgments every day and make your notes. It could be on Bihar Land Act, it could be anything. Just for the sake of understanding the law and the sheer language, how judges used language. If you come across a nice English phrase, note it down. That's the other advice I'll give you. Now, the people ask me, what should I do? Should I specialize or should I generalize? Should I go into general practice? Well, there is no answer. There is no uniform answer. It's a matter of individual choice. My personal view is, after 3 decades in the bar, it is not advisable to straight away jump into specialization. There was a very great lawyer called Ashok Sen, A.K. Sen, who was the first law minister also, one of the early law ministers. And the seniors in Delhi told me that his greatness was that he had done civil law and criminal law initially. And so later in life, his fundamentals are very sound, both on CPC and CRPC. So whenever any youngster comes to me, I tell him, look, if you got the time, instead of pursuing some LLM, first try to work for 1 year in a civil office, learn the basics of CPC, spend 1 year in a criminal office, CRPC. Believe me, all of us, because of medical science, or those of you who are 25, 23, 24, you're going to be looking at a 60-year practice at the bar. All of us are going to live well into our 80s, thanks to medical science. So 2 years doesn't really matter. It will be a huge foundation which will help you later. After that, you decide to specialize. Now, I'll also tell you one more thing. Those of you who want to specialize in taxation or in commercial life, my advice to you is try to get some mastery over accountancy. Either you take tuitions or join ACS or CA, at least do the intermediate course and learn basics of accountancy, which will be a great help in your practice. I appear for SEBI and so on. I find that when there are many company matters, if you know accounts, you're able to understand a balance sheet. You know what's a provision, what's a reserve, why the company is making a loss. All those nuances are there, and it's a great help if you know this thing. For myself, I decided to be a tax lawyer, so I did cost accounting in the evening. I used to come to law college in the morning and go to ICWA class in Monteith Road in the evening. So I did both, and that has been a great help as far as I am concerned in terms of my tax practice. After that, you can specialize. Now, one great advantage all of you have, the younger generation is so lucky, is that there is a large number of tribunals you can work in. When I was practicing, there is nothing except sales tax tribunal, income tax tribunal, there is no other tribunal. It only work in the high court. Today, what do you have? You have the green bench, you have the tax tribunals, then you have various, you have the competition commission, competition appellate tribunal, cyber tribunal, FERA tribunal. There are so many tribunals where also you can specialize and then go on to the high court and supreme court on appeals. So have a look around, see what interests you. For example, consumer practice, at least in Maharashtra, is a huge thing. There are a lot of lawyers who don't have time to go to courts. They are working almost 7 days a week only in the consumer court. That's such a large area of practice. That's also another branch of practice. So before you specialize, my advice is do 2 years of civil work and then choose your specialization. Other thing people ask me is going abroad for an LLM. Now it's become very fashionable for everyone to go to do some LLM in some. It's a choice of yours. If you are going to practice, say for example, in tax law, then I don't think that LLM is going to be of any help, unless you want to just go for an extra year. But otherwise, it won't help. It will be much better to practice as far as you are concerned. One more decision you have to make is whether you are going to do chamber practice or court practice. That's particularly important in Bombay, Delhi, and parts of Chennai. There are people who don't go to court, who do only what they call transaction work, who do only chamber work, who don't go to court. I personally will get bored with chamber work, but there are people who enjoy it, so it's a matter of personal choice. Those who want to practice can stick to court work. Now, finally, I'll just conclude. I just got 5 minutes more. I'll just conclude by telling all of you that when you go back today, set a goal for yourself. Set goals, what you want to do to 2017. Where do you want to be in 2020? What do you want to do by 2020? And then work backwards. For myself, you set 5-year goals and then you work, break it up in parts. Of course, very often you'll go outside your target. But you see, the very strange example given is when a plane goes from Chennai to Delhi, 80% of the time it is getting off course because of winds and so on and so forth. But every time the pilot brings it back and he lands it in Delhi. When a ship sails, often it is completely tossed this way and that by winds and so on, it gets off course. But ultimately from Chennai, if you are going to, let's say, the port of Dubai, you will keep on making course corrections and getting. So like that, once you set your goal, you have to then work towards that goal. And I'll just give you some examples. If you want to note it down, you can note it down. What is the definition of a goal? What is the definition of a goal? When I say this is my goal, I want to participate in the Tokyo Olympics in 2020. That is a goal. What does it mean? Goal, to my mind, the best definition, it is a dream with a deadline. The goal is a dream with a deadline. I want to write a book by 2020. So my dream is to write a book. Year is 2020. And please remember, that just a goal saying I want to earn a lot of money is meaningless. A goal has to be very specific. They say a goal has to be smart, specific, measurable, ambitious, realistic, and timely. So that's how they define it. So you must have a very clear goal. What do you want to do in 2020 and how do you break it down? Because as somebody said, how can you reach a destination when you don't even know where it is? See, 5 years from now, all of us will be somewhere. But are we going to be there by design or by accident? Because as long as you're not dead, you're going to keep going somewhere. But it's our choice that we go to a predetermined destination or we go to a random destination which takes us by fate. I don't believe in fate. I don't believe in luck. It has to be a clear destination and you have to work for it. Remember, Carl Lewis, the great Olympic, he said success is not easy. He said if success was easy, everyone will be successful. Ultimately, it's only the few who will become successful because it requires enormous amount of dedication and hard work. But all of us have the chance of taking a shot at it. So I said that make a goal when you go back. What do you want to do? Maybe as a young lawyer, you may not know. You may think a criminal lawyer, but you may not like it. Doesn't matter. But you can certainly set a goal. I want to be a tax lawyer by 2022. I want to be a leading criminal lawyer. I want to practice in the trial court. Then once you decide that, you plan, set a deadline, then what's the action plan? If you want to be a criminal lawyer, what do? You must master CPC, you must master IPC. Then it necessarily means you don't do anything else. You focus on that particular area itself. And the main thing is, which I am told again and again, is the goal should be mastery in that particular subject. So in terms of goal setting, they say there are basic steps. One is to set the goal. Second is to set the deadline. Third is to have the plan of action. Fourth, you can note down, identify the people who can help you achieve that goal. Suppose you want to do arbitration, then can you come to the Palkhial Arbitration Center, learn more of arbitration? If you want to do criminal law, should you spend more time in trial courts? If you got spare time, go and attend a trial court. See how the seniors are doing the cross-examination. You want to do pollution work, spend time in the green tribunal. See what the cases are going on in the green tribunal. So who are the people and things who will help you? That's the fourth step. Fifth is very important. Who are the people who will obstruct you? What will be the difficulties in your path? You must identify that also. There is something called SWOT, SWOT analysis. Strength, weakness, opportunities and threats. So what are your strengths? What are your weaknesses? What are the opportunities? What are the threats? So identify people who can help you. Identify the potential hurdles that will come in your way so that you will be prepared to meet them. After that, have a clear plan of action. And the most important thing is you must say, why do I want to do it? Why do I want to write the IAS exam? Is it because my father is an IAS officer? It may be something which really ignites a passion in you. You must do it because you really want to do it. Otherwise, it will not work out. So these are the steps of goal setting. Setting a goal, having a deadline, plan of action. Who can help you? Who can stop you? A daily plan of action. And then you must first think about it and say, do I really want to do it? Is my heart is there? Is there what I want to do for the next 10 years of my life? Identify that. And finally, the three steps, as they say, plan, execute, review on a daily basis. So with that, I have advised you more than I wanted to, but I really feel with all sincerity, I can tell you, you have joined a very, very glorious profession. It's a demanding profession, but this is one area where your success is entirely proportional to your efforts. It's not a case where you take up a job, you can be your promotion depends on some internal politics, your promotion depends on so many factors. Despite however good you are, you can't go up to a certain level. That doesn't happen here. If you work hard, you follow the step what your seniors have done, I can assure you that all of you who follow that path will be successful. You cannot fail if you work hard and work sincerely. It's a fantastic, glorious profession. I will not leave it for all the money in the world. And believe me, as far as law is concerned, it's one area where you can really be the master of your own destiny. If there are any questions, you can ask me. Otherwise, thank you very much. Wish you all the best. And when I see you 5 years from now, I want to see very successful young lawyers. Thank you.
So friends, I forgot to announce, make one small announcement.
that there's going to be a junior advocates council. It's going to be formed shortly under the guidance of Justice K. Chandru. We propose to hold lectures once a week or at least once in 2 weeks. So kindly make use of this opportunity and interact with us frequently to get the best out of us. Kindly in touch, be in touch with Durga of NPAC. And I just want to formally thank our team of NPAC, Mrs. Durga, Mrs. Sumati, Mrs. Jaya, Deshingu and Parameswaran for helping us in the event. And also thank the Bar Council, Chennai and Puducherry for this unique joint venture of our conducting series of lectures. Thank you.
Any questions, please? You can ask questions.
Yeah, please. You can ask me whatever questions you want. I'm here for.
Most of the developing countries.
Developing countries.
Developed
countries.
Have a very simple constitution and a enormous constitution which cannot be accepted by implemented advocates. So if there is parliament of people by that more than 100 amendments, and in the case of America, the one of compromises is less than 2.
Well, I don't agree with the proposition that a simple constitution is an easy constitution. What happens is, in a simple constitution, you see, these constitutions were made in the 1900s and 1800s, where there was a basically a few declaration like all men are equal, etc., due process and so on. So, and the point is, everything is left to interpretation. So the law develops in common terms. The advantage of a larger constitution, just everything has got pluses and minuses. Once you have a larger constitution, it becomes slightly rigid, but at least the principles are laid down. For example, take Article 311 for a civil service. How to remove a civil servant, this is mentioned there. Election Commission, there's a particular chapter. Now, what we have done is, we have put all these into the constitution. Why we put the Election Commission into the constitution? Because you can't remove the Chief Election Commission except by impeachment. Judiciary is into the constitution. And don't forget that when we had the constitution, there were 350 million Indians at that point of time. We are still the second largest population in the world. Today we are 1.2 billion. So, keeping in mind our country, again, there are so many states, so many languages, so many cultures. So, this kind of heterogeneous population, in my opinion, requires a large constitution. Overall, I think it brings in more stability. The constitution is well laid down. It's just the application which becomes difficult. Yes. 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 Now, as far as the Westminster model is concerned, it is true that England doesn't have a constitution as like we have. But they have the Magna Carta of 1257, they have the Bill of Rights of 1664, they have numerous small statutes which govern the rights, and the remaining all the statutes are governed by the individual laws. Now, when you talk of the Westminster model, what it means is, a basic concept of Westminster model was Parliament is supreme. Parliament can make any law. That was the Westminster model. We decided that Parliament will not be supreme, the Constitution will be supreme. And within the constitution, we'll have legislature, executive, judiciary, which will all be under the constitution. In the Westminster model, Parliament is supreme. No court can strike down a legislation as far as the British Parliament is concerned. Now, since you've asked this question, as early as after the war, after Nazi Germany, all countries decided that you must have a constitution where you cannot think of another Hitler coming into power. So that's how, if you see the constitutions of Germany, France, etc., post-war, all provide for stronger powers to the judiciary to strike down a legislation. England constitution was in the much earlier days. Now, in England also, in 1998, Tony Blair's government, they had the Human Rights Act with Europe. Okay? Today, UK does not have a written constitution even now. But because of the human rights provisions, Now, I must unfortunately go into detail. See, in UK there is a sovereign parliament, which is the Westminster Parliament, which is the British Parliament, that's sovereign. There is a parliament in Scotland, there is a legislative assembly in Wales, there is an assembly in Ireland. These three are called devolved legislatures. They are subordinate legislatures, like our state legislatures, and British Parliament is supreme. Even today, after the Human Rights Act, the smaller assemblies, Scotland, Ireland and Wales, if their law violates the Human Rights Act 1998 or the European Convention, that law can be struck down as ultra vires. It can be declared invalid. But even today, consciously they have not given judiciary supremacy in England. What the courts can do is they can say your law is incompatible with human rights. After that, it is for Parliament to amend the law or not to amend the law. In India, what happens? If they don't like a particular law, they strike it down. But in UK, the UK Supreme Court will say this particular law is not compatible with your rights. You amend it. They may not amend it, they may amend it. But conventionally, the whole thing can be amended. If you are interested in reading on this point, read Chintan Chandrachud's book, Balanced Constitutionalism. He has compared England and UK very well. So, to answer your question, we adopted principles of Westminster model, but we made the constitution supreme rather than the legislature supreme. Pardon me? No, that's a decided in Keshan Bharati, you can't. Pardon me? Court management. See, all this is all journalistic, with all respect, this 400 is all rubbish, with great respect. They say that if the same number of judges will go to 400 years. You please see the thing, I am not saying that there is no arrears, there is a serious problem, of course there. But there is a larger issue, you don't have judges. The world model is 100 judges per million, we have 11 judges per million, now 13 judges per million. So we have 1/8 the number of judges as required, number one. Secondly, we have a large number of people approaching courts. 45,000 writs in Tamil Nadu alone. So what do? Can I say you can't file a writ petition? You can't. The dose of justice, Supreme Court has said 226 is part of basic structure. You can't take it away. So we have to live with that part of democracy. Again, you can't have too many judges because with quantity, quality will suffer. So there has to be some via media. A lot of it can be avoided. For example, if the pollution is not done, why will you go to green tribunal? So very often the executive doesn't work or the legislature doesn't work, and then Supreme Court has to step in. Thanks. Anything from the youngsters? All right, thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. On behalf of the Bar Council of Tamil Nadu and Puducherry and Nani Balgiwala Foundation, I wish to thank one and all for making this function great success. Now I request you all to rise for national anthem. பட்டாசு அந்த மாதிரி அந்த நடவடிக்கைகள் ஈடுபட வேண்டாம். காவல்துறையில் வந்து உருவாக்கணும்.